Welcome to Macro Hive Conversations with Bilal Hafiz. We aim to bring you the best in macro and markets thinking. To see our latest thoughts and analysis on the world, visit macrohive.com. It really feels like we'll have wild markets as we go into US elections. Most markets seem to be reversing course, and as usual at Macro Hive, we've been publishing great pieces of analysis to help guide you through this turbulence. Importantly, we're not going lowbrow or tabloid and churning out uber-bearish pieces and lots of told-you-so notes. Rather, we're grounding our work on good old-fashioned analysis of the facts. We have pieces on how the Supreme Court nomination is impacting Biden's chances of beating Trump. We take a deeper look at the second wave of COVID cases in Europe. We also look at how large a drawdown we can expect in equities. We also look at whether the US needs another fiscal boost to keep the recovery alive. Then we have an excellent geeky piece on how to trade volatility carry. But perhaps the piece I'm most excited about is that we've released one of our notes that normally is reserved for our more high-end professional membership clients. This is a piece I wrote with star investor Jim Leitner on how the Chinese yuan could strengthen significantly over the coming years. It's related to many of the arguments put forward by Michael Pettis in our last podcast episode. Anyway, if you're a Prime member, you can access this note. And if you're not, make sure to sign up. It's the cost of a few weekly cappuccinos. I should add that many of you have reached out to me to ask more about the trade ideas we produce. These are part of our professional membership, the high-end one, where you could receive notes like the one on China. If you're interested, just drop me an email at bilal@macrohive.com. And for those of you who struggle to spell my name, that's B-I-L-A-L, and then I can tell you more. Now, the timing of this episode's guests couldn't be better. We have Charlie McElligott. Charlie is one of the best guys out there on market microstructure, liquidity, and flow. For background, he's a managing director and cross-asset macro strategist for the Global Markets Americas business at Nomura. He has over 15 years' experience in macro markets. Before Nomura, Charlie was head of US cross-asset macro strategy at RBC, and before that, he spent 8 years at UBS. On to our conversation. So, hey, Charlie, it's great to have you on this podcast episode. I always enjoy speaking to you and also reading your work. I'm less able to do that now. I'm not a Nomura, but when I do see the scrapes of notes on the web, I always enjoy it. So welcome to this episode.
It's good to be here. It's great to see you again, old friend.
Great, thanks. Well, one thing I wanted to start with, Charlie, is I don't actually know a huge amount about your background, how you got into finance in the first place. You know, were you always into finance? Was that something you thought out of college that you wanted to enter finance and banking and trading and so on? What's your origin story?
Absolutely. So I actually came up in 2001 after graduating college at UBS on the NASDAQ desk. So single stock equities, cash equities coming right off of the tech bubble bursting. But it was still cowboy days back then. And, you know, frankly, it was still incredibly linear. You know, it was cash. The great thing, however, about UBS at that time was that it was through prior mergers, much of the product was actually run by old O'Connor generals. And if you remember UBS O'Connor, you know, those are the first guys to be using Black-Scholes and really took the market there by storm. They had a lot of really smart, high-end intellectual capacity guys running businesses, and they made that training program that I was in very early super intense. You know, so I was coming from a government major, qualitative background at a liberal arts college into this very mathematical, very Greeks-oriented worldview. And the training that they put us through was rigorous, and it went from, you know, mock trading to interest rate derivatives kind of in the first month. You know, I think that gave me a nice holistic view, even though I was starting in this very cash world. And then over the course of the next kind of 5 to 6 years, just as the cycle went, you know, we got into this very, you know, bubbly, frothy environment, which set the table for my own career progressing. I was covering a little bit of a hodgepodge, a lot of long short, but also too, there was more interest from macro tourists into the equity space, credit funds, and quant funds in particular, certainly like some of the bigger kind of factor stat RB places that needed to access liquidity of like an upstairs desk instead of algorithms. And all of this culminated in that 2008, 2009 period, frankly, 2007, where there was that incredible great quant blow up, which was frankly picking up like butterfly flapping its wings from the first inklings of what was going to happen in the mortgage space, as one very large asset manager liquidated a liquid equity market neutral portfolio because of issues they're having in the mortgage backside and structured side. And it gave me this view how much bigger the world was. And at that point I said, you know, I've got to take advantage of this world's largest trading floor, which was just one constant flow of information. Started interacting with the credit derivatives folks, started interacting with the rates folks. You know, the equity derivatives folks were, you know, shouting distance over here because I needed to take that information. I saw this great opportunity, especially with the client base I was covering, to take what was really dictating the market, which was not any longer about, you know, fundamentals, balance sheet, things like that, and much more about the macro. And it kind of made that my thing within the equity space. And from there, you know, I just kept growing and stayed intellectually curious. You know, proximity to good derivatives businesses, you know, really kept educated and looking for ways to kind of figure out where the next accident was coming and always kind of keep my eye on the macro. And slowly but surely that transitioned me into strategy, and strategy really best overlapped from a macro perspective with regards to making trades realize within the equity vol space. Certainly with regards to some of the products you could trade, whether it's just vol or ETF vol, singles or index, it was kind of the best place to bring all these things together, certainly with regards to kind of my more tactical view. You know, that long-winded way is how I got to this position where I sit on an equity derivatives desk, but I service all of our global markets businesses, and I really lean on three core pillars. It's our equity derivatives franchise, which is best in class, and, you know, we're the largest risk takers in the business. And then the rates business, which is a top five global franchise. And then our QIS offering. We have a tremendously talented team of guys building out risk premium strategies. They do a lot of work with us with regards to strategy replication. And using those three pieces, it gives me, you know, a great glimpse under the hood, and using those tools to try to take a qualitative 30,000 foot worldview and turn it into kind of a tactical short-term type of trade.
I mean, yeah, one of the things I certainly enjoyed in our time working together was how, although you have this equity sort of heritage, so to speak, I kind of view you as a true sort of cross-markets person. You're one of the few proper cross-asset people out there where you formulate a view on the world. You then bring it down to all the different asset classes. You bring all the flows together. And it truly is kind of a cross-market view that you have. So kudos to you to be able to do that. And I guess, you know, this kind of leads us on to some of your kind of core big picture views. You know, I know you've kind of had this view for a while about the so-called everything duration kind of view, which I think is a great way of looking at the world. You know, perhaps you can elaborate on that, just update us on that theme and, you know, how you think that's affecting markets.
Absolutely. I mean, it's at the core of all, you know, kind of popular cross-asset positioning has frankly been this, you know, decade plus long phenomenon, certainly since the post-crisis, you know, response in 08-09, which is, you know, goes back and looks a little bit like, you know, the spoos and blues phenomenon. But frankly, it began tethering this correlation with duration and central bank levers, which are, you know, left to be pulled with regards to a crisis response. And obviously from a rate policy perspective, with regards to large scale asset purchases perspective, with regards to forward guidance, not just on policy rate, but with regards to shape of the curve. And frankly, too, it had this pronounced effect then on the valuation of other assets. You know, you certainly see the context of, you know, where real yields are nowadays, you know, deeply negative. You know, you can kind of justify any sort of infinite valuation in a lot of different ways. And frankly, that's why, you know, a lot of folks think valuation, you know, as a very young PM, tech PM told me back in kind of late 2016, valuation is an old man's way of being bearish, which really ruffled some feathers. I had to quote that in the piece at one point. But, you know, that's the world order by which, you know, so many of our peers, both buy and sell side now, operate within, that have been in the business over this last decade period. And really what it's contributed to is this dynamic where a world that has been stuck in kind of secular stagnation, or, you know, in large parts, you know, we've had kind of a Goldilocks type of a backdrop with good enough growth, certainly not, you know, overshooting type growth, and certainly, you know, below target inflation has allowed for policy to stay really easy, by and large, with one miserably failed effort at normalizing policy and balance sheet you know, it's forced the Fed to keep the pedal down in this lower and flatter forever type of worldview. And then, you know, you look that in equities and it's become the same trade, the same phenomenon has you know, developed where what is momentum within equities? It's long secular growth, right? It's stuff that doesn't need a hot economic cycle to work. And that's, you know, tech, FANG, you know, high flyers that have become this phenomenon because they have tremendous ability to generate cash without needing to, you know, bring debt in order to fund operations. And those are companies, those types of companies have been, you know, tremendously rewarded during this, you know, funding environment, frankly, versus, you know, being short cyclical stuff. You know, short cyclical stuff makes a lot of sense because you haven't been above trend growth or above trend inflation for, you know, at least a decade. And what that has led to are these, you know, big kind of momentum crowding bubbles where we overshoot to the upside, maybe on some, you know, less bad type of economic data, some potential, you know, geopolitical event, i.e. the Trump election in 2016, which was this shock with regards to business deregulation, lowering taxes, things that got people, you know, excited with regards to growth upside. You know, you have these occasional and very short-term in nature, you know, reversals from bull flattening to bear steepening. And then you get these massive momentum shocks, which you know, create these crash up, crash down types of phenomena got so used to in markets. But the point is that low interest rates allow, justify these extreme valuations and perpetuates this seculars over cyclicals type of a trade. And now, if you look at kind of the, you know, how much length is into fixed income, the bond fund inflows, investment grade in particular over the past decade, which is really got, obviously there's a credit component to it, but it's really, you know, duration. And certainly the equities themes of tech just trades like a bond, right? The S&P has become bond-like because of that nature. I mean, tech, telecom services, and consumer discretionary, which are really kind of the big three secular growth sectors, make up 40% of the S&P index. And obviously, we all have seen what's been going on with NASDAQ. And frankly, you know, again, another decade-long type of a trade, you know, that is a bond proxy. And, you know, it's never lost on me with regards to the way I concentrate on, you know, factors telling a story, telling a macro story, that when curves bull flatten for that funding advantage that these, you know, secular growers have, these cash generating companies have over, you know, heavily indebted deep cyclicals, when curves bull flatten, that's a huge tailwind to growth and thus momentum factor, right? Long the stuff that's working, short the stuff that's not working. That is peak long seculars, short cyclicals. When you get these rare bear steepenings, that's when momentum comes unglued. So much of my framework really is finding out when we're in the midst of one of these, you know, grinding bull flattenings, just what exactly could cause an accident, what exactly could cause a tipping over with regards to asymmetry in the market narrative, with regards to too much skepticism, you know, it's too much focus on rolling crises, what could actually outperform, what could actually upside surprise, those types of moments, trying to tilt at the right time, looking, doing a lot of work with regards to positioning, crowding. And, you know, I try to time those moments for these kind of, you know, cross asset momentum reversals. And we've had a lot of those the last 3 years. That is for sure.
A couple of things from what you've just said. One is on valuation. I mean, should we just throw valuation out the window or not? I mean, do you think there is a role for valuation, or is there a role for a different type of valuation? I mean, if you speak lots of factor guys, I mean, they keep going on about that, you know, the valuation of valuation is so attractive now. You should go long value, short growth. What's your thoughts on value?
Yeah, I mean, you see it, you know, again, you know, risk premia strategies are not just an equities phenomenon, even though, you know, 90% of the street risk premia stuff is certainly based within the equity space, just because of, you know, transparency and history of data from a backtesting perspective. But, you know, value from a cross asset perspective, you know, has been broken for quite some time. And I think that speaks to exactly what we're saying, where, you know, in the world of negative real yields, and frankly, you know, the implication of infinite capital, meaning central bank balance sheets, you know, effectively, dirty little secret, monetizing debt, then it's almost irrelevant to me. And I really don't pay. The only time I pay attention, you know, to valuation is because, you know, valuation is kind of another way to speak to a lot of these most crowded, you know, kind of high flying secular growth stories. it's just another cut of it. I mean, they kind of look the same, you know. It's the some of these names in tech that are trading 10 times their EV are the ones that are up 80, 90, 100% in a year, that on these, you know, bull flattening days, see the NASDAQ up, you know, 1-2%. And you know, as long as bonds stay where they are, it's really hard for bonds to sell off when, you know, at any point central banks can escalate purchases, can change the distribution, the allocation of their purchases across the curve, meaning, you know, tilt towards more into duration, which is something the market is still kind of interested in going forward. And certainly, you know, nobody wants to go there right now. And we just had Kaplan today talk it down again. But if things get squirrely, if we have another disaster with Corona and it, you know, or an election aftermath disaster, they will not be afraid to not only buy more assets, including risk assets, which they're already doing, but also too, you know, I think we still all know that negative rates are very much on the table, even though as conditions stand right now, they're not. And that just opens up a whole new world. So, you know, are you really going to stand in front of that? I think clients have told you over the past 10 years that, you know, that's a widowmaker type of a trade. And why these, you know, frankly, these repricings, these drawdowns don't last very long, because central banks will continue to come in and soothe markets and take policy rates lower, take curves flatter. And then you just got to get back on that kind of risk asset train again.
Yeah. Makes sense. And in terms of those reversals and drawdowns, you know, you say you spend a lot of time trying to identify when we're going to get those. What types of things do you look at? What indicators do you look at? What do you find is reliable? Or maybe it's not one thing, maybe it's a number of things.
Clearly, it's all relative, you know, but we want to look everything from historic percentile ranks with kind of traditional positioning type tools like TFF, you know, CFTC data. But, you know, the stuff that I really get edge on is through a lot of our strategy replication work internally, you know, particularly looking at, you know, systematic strategies, which these are, frankly, by definition, negatively convex. They are short gamma, where in a grinding vol suppressed environment, and a vol suppressed environment is kind of at the core of that is the interest rate volatility repression from central bank policy and asset purchases and the forward guidance. That, frankly, in a kind of a perverse way, forces, you know, you have these trends, and it forces you to deploy more leverage onto these positions to extract your kind of your target return. And what that does is create these classic kind of carry trade dynamics where your Federal Reserve liquidity, moral hazard, the Fed put, few opportunities, risk premia compress. Then you have to deploy more leverage, you have to push further out in the risk curve, more carry trades, more selling of convexity. It's created a new asset class, you know, over the last, you know, decade, frankly, with regards to, you know, short volatility, because traditional buyers of hedges, you know, dating back kind of the early 2000s, real money, right? Pension funds, insurance companies have now turned, you know, the largest sellers of volatility, right? It's not just some insidious hedge fund entities of some computer servers in a dark room somewhere. You know, it's some of the largest, most traditional, you know, almost permanent sources of capital type of players out there that are, you know, the largest systematic sellers of volatility, whether it's rates or equities, just, you know, harvesting strategies, because you have to generate yield, you know, they call them yield enhancement strategy. You have to generate income from shorting volatility. And that's why I look so much at, you know, risk parity replication, CTA replication internally with our QIS teams, because in the, again, post 2008 world, every risk management device, every firm, whether you're fundamental discretionary or systematic, has a, you know, a vol trigger. Your volatility input dictates your exposure. It's the toggle, as I always say. And, you know, frankly, anybody on a VAR model then becomes subject to these types of volatility stop outs. So when I see, you know, in our CTA replication, you know, we look across a variety of blended time horizons, which we weight from 2 weeks to 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, 12 months. We then load across those tenors based on kind of the strongest signal, you know, long or short, you know, canceled noise. And what you end up getting is we can then kind of rank and track the exposure, long or short, to see when you do have these extremes. And it's usually those kinds of, when my spidey senses go up, or when, you know, I hear a narrative building in the market. I feel a crowding with regards to asset returns. And then you see, you know, in this world where it's, you know, trend, more leverage, you get a macro shock. It just so happens that a lot of these, you know, negative gamma or negative convexity events tend to corroborate or correspond with where our CTA trend model would actually, you know, pivot from, you know, to a deleveraging point. And, you know, when you get those two things corresponding with each other, it's very, you know, it's common that where we see, you know, one of our equity option positioning metrics, you know, looking at where the, you know, where dealer gamma is and where kind of the neutral line is and where we would be flipping into short gamma territory, oftentimes those do in fact correspond with a level where we would see CTA deleveraging from a prior kind of legacy long. And that's where you get these shocks. That's where you get those flushes. So it's a multi-factor approach. There is a qualitative aspect to it because, again, it really to me is all about when I just hear too much consensus, that's when I get nervous. And then I look and see, you know, some of these tools, particularly tools that are vol-based exposure strategies, and then we kind of reverse engineer it from there.
I mean, just for the benefit of our audience, I mean, the way I'd kind of look at this would be to say that there's all of these trend following type strategies in the market, and CTA is obviously one of them, trend following. And so you've developed a way, or you and the QIS team developed a way to sort of mimic those strategies that are widely employed by lots of funds out there. And from that, you're able to determine whether they're long or how long they are. And obviously they have to target a certain level of volatility. So volatility get shocked higher, they'll have to deleverage, or if that coincides with a macro event, then you have a sense of how much of an unwind, how much they have to reduce their positions. And that gives you a good kind of sense of potential kind of expected flow almost in the market.
Yeah, exactly. And look, sometimes these things, I often get asked because we've had almost eerie success at times with regards to the handle, you know, breakpoints where you get, you know, kind of huge market swings. And then through there, you get this very negatively convex type of movement, meaning you have to sell more the lower it goes, you have to buy more the higher it goes. Do you attribute to, say, the CTA universe per se? And look, that part of the market per Barclay Hedge, which tracks the actual assets of underlying funds, it's not a model, it's the real numbers. You know, you're dealing with 300 billion plus of real assets in probably one of the most extremely leveraged strategies out there. So, you know, you're dealing with legit trillion and a half, you know, safe, plus risk parity, which is slower moving by far, and slower, you know, slower moving in the sense that even after the March vol shock of this year, they're still completely defanged with regards to an exposure, just because that vol shock is still in their sample set and it hasn't allowed them to really leverage. You know, when you're looking at the notionals behind some of these things, not to mention too, you know, structured product out there, that you're really talking about stuff that moves the market. In addition to that, though, like in addition to these real flows that are out there, that there is a self-fulfilling nature to them. And, you know, folks that are trying to trade around this from a discretionary perspective, and we've been told this directly, you know, we keep your daily buy or sell triggers up on the screen. And, you know, sometimes we'll try to self-fulfill and take it there to kind of force the move. So, you know, I think there's a little bit of finger in the air, a little bit of, you know, tail wagging the dog, you know, to a certain extent here too. But it's important because I think at the end of the day, one of the things that I really want to make clear is that everybody is a trader when volatility is the toggle by which these, you know, these flows and this market structure operates within.
I mean, I guess that kind of begs the question of who is a buyer of vol or gamma or convexity in any normal period of time? I mean, are we in a sort of unusual state post 2008 where everybody's on the same side? You know, there's kind of no one on the other side to create that two-way.
It's look, I mean, this is at the core, man. I mean, dealer desks from a 10-year today versus 10 years ago perspective, just saying like the equity vol side, you could probably take down an aggregate back then, you know, $100 million of Vega. Now there's maybe three players that can do $3 million of Vega. And that is because of the regulatory implications of Dodd-Frank and Volcker, right, wrong, or indifferent. And we have seen this recently with regards to that August melt up in NASDAQ and ensuing collapse. You can unpack later if you want, or, you know, again, multiple times in the past few years where you end up having a couple trades for large entities that get, that do get the street, you know, short gamma. It's like a golf ball through an earthworm. There is no ability to go out and kind of hedge yourself as a dealer without creating this kind of ballooning recycling. And that's a real big deal. It's a real big deal, frankly, into this election. I'm telling you, because we've already seen this type of dynamic develop. Implieds are still rich, but they're starting to not give back much. And I'm saying implieds is implied vol, you know, certainly out, you know, term structure wise. And tails have cheapened for sure off of, after we did finally catch this recent kind of crash down move in NASDAQ. But like, they're going to stay sticky because no dealers from a risk management perspective, you know, with regards to, you know, reporting to the big bosses and reporting to the feds, you know, you're not able to be short crash. You can't be short crash down, or you can't be short crash up. You know, you can't be short crash up was kind of what happened over the course of August with NASDAQ into that peak melt up and then ultimately collapsed under itself. But, you know, this idea that nobody's going to be able to short a bunch of optionality, you know, around such an event risk and such an absolutely impossible number of scenarios and permutations, especially with regards to what, you know, kind of forward vol is pricing and term structure is pricing, that's going to create a lot of weird feedback loop looking out November, December, potentially even into January. There will be opportunities, you know, somebody is, I wrote about this yesterday in the hope, but like, you know, there will be some brave buy-sider who's going to try to harvest, you know, some of this crazy rich upside vol premium, not upside vol, but vol premium in that kind of December area where, because nobody knows how long this is going to prolong in these worst case scenario election disasters, somebody will try to, you know, short that, and you're either going to make a career on that trade because we don't realize the worst case scenario, total chaos doesn't ensue, streets aren't burning, and we do actually get a decision, or it's just that we can handle 3% moves a day, but we're pricing it more than that, and vols will still come in. You know, that matters. Or that brave person who is out there selling, and we do get a bad situation, you know, gets absolutely wiped off the face of the earth.
Yeah. Let's talk a bit more about the August melt-up and what we've been seeing recently. I mean, what was your interpretation of that? You know, because, you know, there was lots of stories in the market and all these sorts of flows and things like that. I mean, what was your take on that melt-up?
There's certainly no ability to speak to theoretical, you know, entities in the market, but certainly would say, you know, as we had written about over the course of that week and, you know, frankly, you know, weeks before, that there was a flow institutionally going through the market that was unlike anything the market had seen, certainly in the last decade plus, with regards to the scale of the magnitude of the premium bought in upside vol, but within, you know, a number of bellwether mega cap tech leaders and, you know, single name type of stocks. And, you know, in various shapes, in various forms, you know, I'm not saying that everything was like rage, bullish upside grab. Some of this stuff was, you know, potentially looking like stock replacements. It's hard to say, but, you know, there's certainly two were like risk reversals, call spreads, outright calls. Just on the listed market alone, it's very possible that there was, you know, huge OTC behind that. And, you know, it goes back to my point earlier, completely outsized dealers' ability to, you know, to hedge out their own risk. And these flows were just going through, you're talking like 4 billion plus in premium, tens and tens of billions of notional, you know, the amount of short crash up that dealers on the other side are suffering from, you know, they have to then go out and buy lookalike upside exposure because you can't do it all from like single name delta. You can't do it all from these individual stocks just going out and buying stock. So, you know, it's S&P options, it's index futures, it's, and everybody's taking everybody else. And, you know, you have this like classic short gamma melt up at the same time that, you know, we're in the midst of this other very notable idiosyncratic with regards to the pandemic, this stay at home Johnny day trader thing, right? You know, the Barstool Sports Robin Hood phenomenon where people who have been stuck at home, haven't had sports to gamble on, are losing their minds with, you know, the kids running around the house, and you're getting a stimulus check. And you just happen to have a bunch of platforms that have turned, you know, day trading into video games, you know, commission free with the not so dirty little, well, not totally dirty, but not so little secret of, you know, they give away their order flow to high frequency trading. That's the way it's free. But, you know, what ends up happening is that all of these people in this whole, you know, YOLO trading environment, you know, began to self-fulfill the market higher too, right? They were buying, you know, one day expiration, kind of 10% out of the money calls in Tesla that were, you know, realizing every Friday. It was absolute insanity. And what those types of short dated options, and look, you know, the competitor did a brilliant, just a lot of work to do this, but, you know, did a brilliant deconstruct a volume profile of like the options market over the last few years. And, you know, I was kind of looking at anywhere, you know, recently, kind of July, August, where almost upwards of kind of 2/3 to 3/4 of all options volume was in 1 week to 2 week expiry option. And what that just creates is enormous convexity. So you take these two things, overlap them, and create this much kind of negative convexity into, you know, what was already a trending market with some legitimate background to that, right? I mean, obviously, after the pandemic event, you had this fall shock and this kind of absolute worst case scenario, you know, outlook with regards to future growth, and certainly with regards to the implications of that on inflation. Boom, everything duration trade. Boom, everybody overhedged. Boom, everybody's in cash, you know, which can created the perfect kind of short squeeze melt up opportunity as, you know, fiscal started pumping, you know, frankly, at levels we've never seen before, and on a kind of global harmonized front. Germany took the boot off of austerity with regards to debt mutualization in Europe, and that had been a huge weak link with regards to global growth for, you know, better part of a decade, you know, with their corona bonds and obviously U.S. fiscal. We saw Republicans and Dems come together on the first kind of few versions of it, and China doing their usual thing in conjunction with the fiscal and in conjunction with the asset purchases and outright risk assets, i.e., you know, high yield credit in the U.S. with the Fed bond. You know, you had an actual then economic upside surprises off of these total finger in the air, worst case scenario estimates, you know, rolling for months. You know, you're really cooking with grease there with regards to a snapback trade. And you got all that, but then you add this short convexity.
I mean, on the August melt up, then how would you trade that? Because it starts accelerating away from you to the upside. I mean, how do you know when to either short the index or those names, or when to get out? How do you kind of go about trying to work out the transition point from the melt up to the meltdown or the unwind?
Yeah, so I wrote a note on the 4th, which was 2 or 3 days before like the one crash, just explaining this dynamic to clients, right? Negative convexity. You know, negative convexity cuts both ways, just meaning that so often people associate, you know, negative gamma, maybe that aren't in the vol space, with, you know, these crashes, but it, you know, you crash up too. And it was this idea, as I said, you can't be short crash up from a risk management perspective, especially dealers who are short all of this upside volatility. So that was, you know, this kind of final match on the lighter field. Plus, you know, the retail stuff that was going through that was just enormous. And frankly, in a lot of these same overlapping NASDAQ secular growth high flyer names. So there was that added leverage to it. But I actually said, you know, with regards to kind of like looking for, you know, looking for a signal, I wrote this note hilariously on September 3rd. Which was the day of the crash. I said, the equity vol market's acting broken and it's indicative that something's got to give. And I basically said, it's a recipe for tears and there's potential that you're going to get a down 6, down 8 single day in NASDAQ. Lo and behold, it happened that day. You know, we were down 6% by 3:30 that afternoon. But, you know, frankly, what it was, it's just more of that, you know, you got to have a rigorous process. And it was looking at these vol indicators, like spread between UX1 and UX2, record steep contango, but huge backwardation in the mid to long end curve. Like that's abnormal. You know, 10 delta, 25 delta put skew hitting new year plus highs. That wasn't the case at the prior all-time market high in February. You know, you didn't see downside acting like that then. So, you know, it said something weird was going on in the tail space. You know, massive premium. This was the biggest thing. Massive premium of implied vol versus realized vol, you know, because of that tech upside premium buyer and all that dealer short gamma hedge spillover.
And when you look at realized vol, what window do you look at? Do you kind of tend to look at the sort of the past month or past week or past 3 months? I mean, that's always a question with this realized vol.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's based on that same market structure, you know, construct that I was outlining earlier, you know, vol control product, right? Which is kind of like a proxy for like variable annuity type business out there, you know, which again, volatility is your exposure toggle, right? And it means a target, you know, you have a volatility threshold, which dictates your target equities allocation, you know, and it might go equities to cash. It might go equities to fixed income. It might go equities into low beta defensive, but you see the dynamic, right? It's kind of like upshift, downshift type of a vehicle. And I think in light of these ever shrinking time horizons on trades, and we feel it, you feel it in the market, right? Where, you know, there's so much data scraping, so many tools, so much AI, machine learning, you know, TensorFlow, all of these vehicles that people use to rip apart data. I think we go and extract that alpha. We, as people or machines, immediately identified and just leave the carcass and go on to the next one. And it's created the, you know, this ever shrinking time horizon these trades. So like vol control is a really good indicator to me. And we also have a vol control model there too, which, you know, for our model just takes the max of 1 month realized or 3 month realized, you know, and I think that those are the right time horizons where, if you are too long, if you are, you know, like a 6 month or 12 month, you know, and kind of in a traditional trend following area, you can miss a turn. You can miss these shocks. And you could still be kind of like averaging down to a loser type of. You need a short enough window so that these shocks, which are just a fact of nature now, register and can cause a reversal. Now, on the flip side, too short of a window and you're just chasing yourself into knots and you're flipping from long to short and covering again and going long again. It's too noisy. So it's really about, you know, kind of finding the right two, which is why, you know, our model looks at either the max of the 3 month or the max of the 1 month. But, you know, there was actually an article about this in Bloomberg just yesterday talking about how, you know, CTAs have been having a rough year in general for this very reason. And that a lot of funds are responding by moving into shorter time horizon, loading heavier weighting into their shorter time horizon buckets.
Yep, understood. In terms of the very recent sort of price action, or say this week, you know, stocks have sold off in general. What's your kind of view right now in this kind of correction? I mean, are we kind of in a serious or dangerous zone right now, or are we kind of more of a kind of consolidation as we go into elections?
The first wave, you know, I talked about those extremes with regards to some of the moves in the vol space that just, you know, made me feel uncomfortable. And as I said, you know, an accident is going to happen. This is not normal. And this implied versus realized thing has to compress. And my guess was that it was realized was going to crash up into where what implieds were pricing. And that's what happened. You know, you had a spot up, vol up dynamic in August. And that always should be a red flag. Then you had, because vol was so rich after that realized, and plus after just the kind of the artificial nature of all that buying demand in the upside vol stuff, then you had this period where like implied was so high just from a base effect level, it just was going to crash. So you had a vol down, spot down in the ensuing aftermath. Last week, you started getting, you know, and frankly, a week and a half ago, you started getting folks trying to take advantage of that rich implied, you know, savvy, bull savvy guys. And try to come in and start, you know, putting on some of these, you know, type of buy the dip expressions, which you sell puts to buy calls, kind of risk reversal types of things, call spreads, just taking advantage of extreme richness and stuff that's less, you know, likely to happen, but still, you know, to get some upside exposure on. Like that was the right behavior too, muscle memory wise, conditioning wise, know that these shocks have tended to be, when there's not really a macro catalyst, have tended to get kind of eaten up, digested by the market, and snapped back, you know, shortly thereafter. So you had, with regards to NASDAQ last week, you know, leverage funds bought $3.5 billion of NASDAQ futures. Asset managers bought another $2.5 billion last week. So there was this kind of buy the dip. Now you're dealing with indigestion. And you know, the final point I would make that, you know, at the end of last week, I again said, we had quadruple witch, we had serial expiration. You know, those are the big quarterly expirations in the S&P that are always the biggest, especially in the kind of coronavirus aftermath period where there was so much hedging that was going on with clients. This was just going to be a massive expiration. And what we saw, particularly around people hedging this very popular legacy decade-long kind of trade in NASDAQ, FANG, secular growth high flyers, is that a massive amount of gamma, of the dollar gamma, was going to come off after that expiration. And my message was, look, historically, anytime to serial expiration, you tend to have a trade up into and then a trade down after. And in this case, it also corresponded with, because all this gamma was going to come off, which means that some of that, you know, if dealers traditionally are in like kind of a long gamma environment, they help insulate the market, right? They sell strength and buy dips, you know, in the sense that that, you know, was going to just come off after expiration. You now were opening up a huge price range, you know, and the fact is that historically after these, you trade down, you know, is meaningful just from a seasonal perspective. Plus there's also like another phenomenon here, which is that, you know, well over half of the S&P 500 now is in their buyback blackout. It's kind of sticking in this week, kind of end of last week, this week too. And when you add in kind of like third idiosyncratic element with like interactive brokers raising margin requirement 35% this week, which speaks to, you know, a real shoulder tap in a lot of ways for the retail set that has chased this thing and doesn't know what they're doing and have been lit on fire in their options accounts the last few weeks. You know, you have some, you know, you have the kindling there for, you know, some potential shocks. I do think that right now the S&P has done a really nice job. And I think as people have adjusted, I think the S&P is less of a short gamma situation now. In fact, I think, you know, people have come in to try to, you know, sell vol. And, you know, from the client side, and it's gotten dealers, you know, it's gotten dealers like a little bit longer gamma. So we actually do end up kind of keep, you know, sticking back in and around here, like 3230 right now. That's been a pretty like sticky spot-ish, 3230, 3250. NASDAQ is still, you know, is still tricky just because a lot of that legacy positioning out there from those big summer flows that we talked about, you know, that stuff is going from September through February. And that's going to keep things really jumpy in NASDAQ. And from the perspective of knowing from a single name, thematic factor perspective, that that's where anybody who's still alive from a performance perspective has been hiding in, you know, long secular growth, long tech, you know, short cyclicals. There's just a lot of crowding. And that's what, you know, that's what yesterday was. One of those metrics that we use is you know, we look at large lot size imbalances in futures. And yesterday, you know, which as a proxy for the asset manager long, which as of a month ago was 100th percentile from a notional perspective in S&P futures. And we just know that, you know, all day from the get-go, it just looked like VWAP selling from that large lot balance perspective, which just tells me people were taking down their exposure because they were too long. They've made a ton of money in this trade. It's not pain necessarily, but they just got to get less long, certainly ahead of, you know, obviously such an event risk as well.
Yeah. And you mentioned the blackout on share buybacks. Have you done much analysis on that? I mean, does that actually work as a signal, or do you use it as a background indicator?
Yeah, you know, it's tricky because, you know, buyback has been a factor, you know, that people have traded off of for a very long time. But what you also get too is a lot of the largest buyback folks end up looking, you know, at times it's very bank heavy without question. Obviously right now, the banks having to put the kibosh on their buybacks for, you know, the AP purposes and the bad optics of that, you know, it ends up looking like a lot of the big tech companies. So there is a certain noisiness to that. But the fact of the matter is, and I just know this from having sat on these desks, that yes, there are programs called 10b5-1s that allow corporates to buy even during the blackout, which is that kind of 1 month out from your earnings. But what it does, it restricts you. It makes it harder. It makes you less tactical. It makes you more passive. So it's not as impactful. And that's kind of like the bottom line here. That stuff does matter. Not to mention too, the fact that it also plays back into, you know, other phenomenon that markets scrape, which is seasonality. And the fact that the buyback seasonality is part of that trade up into serial OPEX, trade down out of serial OPEX, there's a feedback loop. And whether it's which came first, the chicken or the egg, that might be hard to disaggregate, but it's part of that signal, and it matters. And that seasonality matters. And seasonality is part of what we do.
Understood. And, you know, do you have any favorite trades right now?
Well, you know, I think what I'm looking at are actually trades that look, you know, with regards to, you know, clearly this, you know, event risk coming up. I believe at my core, and investors are positioned this way, as per our kind of opening comments on the everything duration trade, that, you know, you're dealing with a clients are long secular growth, short cyclicals. Clients are long duration and, you know, short inflation by and large on a multi-year perspective, because they are long-term believers in secular stagnation. And that is the, you know, the classic three Ds. You know, debt is disinflationary, tech disruption is disinflationary, and demographics are disinflationary. I don't think, by and large, the crowd has shifted from that. In fact, in light of the, you know, the implications of what this virus has done to the global economy, on top of the damage done from the trade tariff, the dynamic, you know, Brexit, things of that nature, like it's only added to the comfort of kind of just staying with your safety blanket of long stuff that has duration sensitivity, because central banks, we know, are totally asymmetric with their policy now. There is no very low bar to cut, an extraordinarily impossible multi-year bar to hike ever again, especially with the scar tissue of 2018 still in a lot of these same folks' minds. That said, what I do like is the idea that, classic to how I operate, you know, what could go wrong? And I think, for instance, right, if you're talking about people looking at election trades, you're dealing with this, you know, a kind of a generic view, you know, Biden equals a growth in US dollar negative, just on, you know, corporate tax policy, capital outflows, loss of tax haven status, re-regulation, all of these things, you know, are out there, understood, and make a lot of sense to us, right? I also, too, though, think that, you know, in light of this groupthink, in light of the legacy crowding into everything, recent long rates, long treasuries, the risk becomes that blowing out deficit spending, you know, with like kind of the death of austerity, if you're talking about a blue sweep, then it's a very different world. We've lived in a world of gridlock.
Yeah.
We've gotten used to a world of gridlock, right? Split White House, split House, split Senate. And, you know, this blue wave is, you know, a much harder trifecta to pull off, but it's a real thing that I think is still somewhat underpriced by the market. And the risk is that you get a blowout in deficit spending, you know, through government spending and fiscal unleashed. We know how much advocacy there is behind the concept of universal basic income already, let alone before the pandemic, right? And then, you know, the potential for this, you know, infrastructure, you know, renewables, Green New Deal type of mentality with a lot of the, you know, the more progressive side of the left, you could really catch, you know, inflation skeptics flat-footed. So, you know, these are more kind of structural backbook trades, but, you know, something that looks like, you know, long real yield, short nominals, so like long tip, short treasuries. You know, it would, you know, this would also look like a bear steepener. It would look like a, you know, maybe a payer contingent on gold, because gold is just a proxy on real yields, right? You know, the reason you would do that way is to cheapen the cost of the option. But, you know, it's a similar dynamic in equities, right? Where, you know, the general assumption is, you know, Trump would be a more value, meaning the more cyclical stuff type of beneficiary, whereas Biden would be maintenance of, you know, status quo. I just went through the reasons why Biden might not be such a status quo, even though I think it's possible that you do get like a bull flattening immediately after a Biden victory, you know, depending on the circumstances, of course, and civil unrest and things like that notwithstanding. But, you know, you end up taking like a very long style risk, you know, because you, you know, in a kind of a typical Biden basket that a lot of banks are making out on the street, because it really just looks like long momentum, you know? So you would need to really go through granularly on the kind of sector by sector level and find, you know, winners and losers across, you know, tax regulation and, you know, financial regulation, climate change, you know, energy renewables, infrastructure winners. Like, that's the way that I operate. Again, I try to find like what is perceived to be consensus and just figure out, you know, what could go wrong to me. I do think that, you know, from a hedging perspective, and our team is currently pushing this on the desk, that if Biden is the chalk, if Biden is kind of the obviously the perceived favorite, and he's polling, you know, continually pretty well here, that, you know, the better trade, and you're already in the status quo, right? You're already long momentum, you're already long secular growth, you're already long, short cyclicals, then you should probably, you know, be hedging, you know, this. So what you'd want to do is kind of be long the Trump leg, short the Biden leg, because, you know, in a scenario where you actually have a liquidity event, and, you know, with a shock because of prolonged like indecision on who the actual victor is, and you have market volatility, it could end up being a situation, especially into year end, tax purposes and things like that. You could have a situation where people sell their winners, which would be a kind of a short momentum trade. And in a lot of ways, long Trump is short momentum, long value. So that, you know, that's the way I try to think about, you know, a lot of these scenarios. And just, you want to find a lot of kind of like implicit leverage, you know, in these trades, like convexity. And you know, sitting on a vol desk, that's what you're always looking for, cheap convexity. You know, you're short the meat, as my vol trader says, and you're long the heat. You want to get long cheap tails if at all possible, and you try to do that by being, you know, short the mundane stuff.
Yeah, that's great. Well, I thought we could move on from market talk, and I always like to ask some personal questions to our guests. Well, the first one I like to ask is more about how you manage your information flow and research. And I mean, there's so much that can overwhelm you, and especially yourself. I mean, you sit on a big trading desk, you've seen so much. I mean, how do you filter everything? How do you not just get overwhelmed by all of the data and information?
Yeah, it's an ongoing challenge. You sat there, you know exactly what I'm talking about. What you do is you surround yourself with the right filters, right? People who can help you avoid confirmation bias, right? People who have opinions whose views you might not always agree with, but gives you, you know, some perspective. Clearly, there's a ton of information sharing. The biggest part, you know, I have 3,000 some institutional clients on my distribution list, which is kind of managed from a, you know, revenue they pay the firm type of, you know, perspective. I'm not a typical researcher, I'm a best strategist. And the thing is, you know, there are exceptions made for people that are great sharers of information. Like, I need that feedback loop. I need people to push stuff upstream and say, you know what, I actually disagree with you here. I'm hearing this kind of goes against what you're saying here, you know, as a heads up, this. And my feedback loop is my eyes and ears. So I'm like a crowd. I'm almost like crowdsourcing. And I have this really convenient vehicle, which is my quasi daily note, as this push out vehicle, which then people will then respond to. And it's just like streaming back and forth information all day, just based around this one email, where it keeps me hyper tactical, it keeps me current, it keeps me aware of kind of what's trending and what's not. And that's a very different seat than on top of sitting on this trading desk, outside of somebody who's kind of behind the hockey rink, you know, wall of like traditional research, where it's much more isolated. And, you know, I think it's probably harder to get the pulse. And as we've, you know, talked about throughout this chat, the shrinking time horizons and the quickening pace of the crash down, crash up turns, it doesn't allow the luxury of a lot of like long-term structural thought. You know, you got to be finger on pulse.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. I mean, since you came outside of a bank environment, I've definitely found, or outside of the traditional research type setup, I've definitely found it's much easier to access networks, information flows. There's less sort of barriers. And that becomes so, so important, especially when it's against your view, because it's so easy to just to have that filter bubble where you just listen to the stuff that reinforces your view. But I always look out for stuff that makes me feel uncomfortable.
Yes.
Another question I'd like to ask you on sort of productivity hacks and things like that. I know you're really into health stuff, as I am in some areas. I mean, what are some of the things you're into on that side?
So this is funny, but people that know me know that this is a big part of me. Is I was a college football player, you know, in the States growing up, and so much of that was just about like eat calories, consume calories, you know. And what I, you know, found is that, you know, after that, those days had ended. Certainly with like the Wall Street lifestyle and being out late and not sleeping much and the intensity and the pressure of the day, you know, my first kind of decade in the business was not a good place. And by the time I was, you know, pushing into my younger 30s, like I was too cloudy. You know, I was not as sharp as I needed to be. And right around the time I got married in 2009, I was getting pretty heavily back into working out and CrossFit. It challenged a lot of kind of conventional wisdom to its credit, both with regards to exercise and you know, particularly its affiliation kind of with paleo diet, you know, some people say. And it was really just this idea of like stripping out inflammatories, stripping out refined stuff, eating stuff that will spoil, basically, you know. So now 11 years almost, I've eaten a diet that is basically fat, vegetables, a small amount of fruit, and, you know, nuts and seeds, no dairy, no legumes, no grains. And I mean, I still will say this to the day, it was never about like weight or anything, the aesthetic for me. It was about brain function and clarity and energy levels. And I'm telling you, within 2 weeks, the mental clarity that I felt, that, you know, what once was a midday lull and loss of focus and loss of train of thought and just general clouding, was absolutely wiped. And that creates a positive feedback loop where my whole family operates like that, wife cooks like that, kids eat like that. And that's been a big deal with regards to me continuing to press, you know, down this path of like stripping out inflammatories.
And so on meat itself, you know, how much meat do you have? What type of meats?
Yeah, I mean, I'm equal opportunity employer. I kind of have like a aging hormone specialist doctor who just did my panels, and he's like, you have the lipid panel and inflammation panel of a professional athlete. Now, you know, we're pretty strict with this stuff, but, you know, there's, you know, fat doesn't make you fat. And in a lot of cases, it's pro heart health, things like that. So like, I want fat, I want oil, you know? So like, that's my big thing. I love Bulletproof. Bulletproof was kind of my first foray into the kind of nootropics world. I have probably have 24 ounces of Bulletproof coffee every morning of, you know, my coffee blend plus, you know, grass-fed butter or ghee plus collagen protein plus the prebiotic. You know, it is my thing where I come out of the gates at 3 a.m, kind of New York time, and I'm crushing it. You know, I wake up bright.
Did you just say 3 a.m.?
Yeah.
You wake up at 3 a.m.?
Yes, sometimes a little earlier.
What time do you go to bed?
You know, when the kids go down, I go down. You know, 8 o'clock, dad is, and mom for that matter, because she also is in the business and also wakes early. So our whole household is on kind of the same page where, you know, that alarm goes off, and there's no, you know, obviously with regards to the work from home environment, it's a lot easier to pull off because you can hit the ground running. But yeah, just between the energy level, between, you know, fat is brain food. It's a better source of energy. It's 2 times the source of energy of a simple carb. It's just been a really big deal for me. And then I heavy into supplementation from, you know, anti-aging things like NAD and resveratrol and super doses of vitamin D and vitamin B to, you know, stuff like, you know, pro hormone things that, you know, I feel like give me, you know, a nice edge. And it's really, at the end of the day, it comes down to the mental edge. It's not about, you know, the physical per se. I just feel very clear of thought. You know, that's at the core of the business when you got to kind of stick your neck out frequently and, you know, get ready to get punched in the face, you know, for the bad call.
And just going back to the diet, I'm always intrigued by diets because I try to, although I've totally failed during the lockdown period, but my general thing is vegan with fish. That's kind of the area I lean toward. But all my discipline's broken down since lockdown. But what's your average breakfast then? Do you go for the Bulletproof coffee? Is that your breakfast?
That's a great nuance there. So there are times where I will absolutely go intermittent fast where, you know, I haven't eaten since 6 o'clock the prior night and I'll just have my Bulletproof coffee, you know, 12 hours later, where this heavy fat dose of caloric to kind of, you know, break the fast. But then too, breakfast can be the cleanest paleo meal out there. Ton of eggs, avocados, uncured bacon, also our guacamole or something like that. I mean, that's boom. I mean, that's phenomenal. A lot of people say like they think it's complicated somehow. You go out to, you know, especially before New York was closed down, you know, even here in the New Jersey suburbs, like, what do you do at a restaurant? Well, it's the easiest thing in the world. I mean, every meal should have a protein base, a side of steamed vegetables, and, you know, there you go. So it's very manageable in that sense. We invest in ourselves because it's what's important. My brain is my most important asset, you know, outside of my family, of course. And like with that, you know, you pay for what you get. So those Amazon Whole Foods bills are strong, and we make sure to utilize all those points that we accumulate. During the pandemic, garage turned a local distribution center.
Well, we have 6 chickens ourselves, so we have fresh eggs every morning.
That's amazing. I absolutely love it. My wife has been pushing that so hard for the longest time. If you're able to
get other people to mind the store in this case, that's a huge one. I love the concept. I don't know if I can trust everybody else to take care of it, is my only concern.
And just on the supplements, on the nootropic side, what types of things do you take? I mean, I supplement with the lion's mane, for example, the mushroom. What do you use?
So I take one product called Qualia Mind, you know, without giving like a sponsored view, but it is from a all-in-one tremendous list of nootropins perspective. And I take the caffeine-free version of it because I'm clearly getting that, you know, with my Bulletproof in the morning. That is the kind of one-stop shop for me that is just brilliant. And there's a lot of people, a lot of aging specialists, a lot of kind of contemporary nutritionists and things of that nature who are, you know, brain hacker guy, the Dave Aspreys of the world from Bulletproof, et cetera, who, you know, ascribe to, you know, to these types of products. And, you know, there's like random stuff in there from like, there's artichoke, you know, skins and different tree barks, but that have shown to, you know, have this, you know, profound, you know, impact on short-term concentration and cognitive abilities, and it's over the counter. So, you know, that's very important to me. Plus like cumin, things like that, which are, or from an inflammation perspective, it just leaves me feeling very highly functional.
And what's your exercise regime?
Again, coming from the days of I lift things up and I put them down era of my life, you know, a big guy from football days. Now I'm almost exclusively body weight. I still do, you know, certainly with regards to what's happened during the pandemic and stay at home training, you know, I still do have like kettlebells, still have some weighted dumbbells. I still do have a bench press, where just I'll be able to do some like core type of movements. But generally speaking, man, like I'll say this to anybody, I have an app on my phone. It's called like a deck of cards workout. Each card has a value, obviously. Each suit has an exercise. So like burpees, push-ups, sit-ups, and body weight squats. And if you tap through, it's 104 reps each of those exercises on a random number generator, basically. You know, that's a hotel workout. It's low-tech, no-tech, requires no space. That body weight type of stuff, it's like a circuit, and there's nothing worse in the world than a burpee workout, which means it's really awesome for you. That's it, man. You don't need to do much more than that.
And how often? Every day? A couple of times a week?
Yeah, I would say, you know, more than a couple of times a week. We have, you know, three kids under eight. It's trickier. And work is demanding. But yeah, if I can get three proper burn sessions like that a week, you know, with the other stuff. And frankly, even though I wake up early, I still get a good square 7 hours-ish of sleep a night, which is, you know, solid. And that matters. And I feel like I'm in better physical place now than maybe I even was 20 years ago. And I really mean that. So that's rare. And, you know, I got to continue to invest in myself like that.
Yeah, absolutely. Totally agree. This is a very personal question now. What's the deal with the beard?
You know, it happened on garden leave when I was coming over to join Nomura. And I think part of it was just, it felt so damn nice not to have to shave every day. There was no long-term intent. By the time I started, I kind of asked my, you know, I think the week before I joined, I asked my new boss, said, hey, I got this thing going. I want to make the right impression. I don't want to think I'm some Unabomber. Is this okay? He said, just, you know, do your job. We don't worry about that stuff here. Best boss I've ever had. And it's just been an incredible experience. But yeah, it's kind of become this thing. Now my kids don't, you know, one of my children has never even seen me without it. The kids honestly don't remember what I look like without it. They get confused when they see me in old pictures. So it's kind of become this thing that I don't know if I can unwind. I told my wife the other day, I'm like, I think the only way this comes off is if you let me just leave absurd mustache. And she quickly shot that down. I think we're stuck for a while. I do look forward to the day where I can go back to the barber and get it trimmed, because right now it's totally unruly, as you're able to see on this little Zoom call. But it's kind of become part of the identity.
No, it's great. I mean, I think also it also probably filters out the type of places that you would want to work at. You know, like if a company wouldn't accept your beard, that probably tells you they're quite limited in their way of thinking. So you're actually with people who are just there for your ideas rather than the way you look.
100%. I feel it. I mean, I'm not kidding. I mean, you get the look up and down for sure when you go into a place. People oftentimes are not sure. You need somebody in town. They're trying to figure out what I do for a living.
You know, I've had beard of varying lengths over the years, but I find that with my skin color and my name, Bilal Hafiz, with a big beard, sort of limits my ability to, at the very least, go to airports for sure. And so for me, I need to be more careful.
You're a handsome guy too. It's a nice base to feature. I'm covering something far less, you know, benevolent.
Just a final question I wanted to ask you, because I'm a big reader, love books. I mean, has there been any book that's really influenced you, whether it's at work or your lifestyle or the way you look at life? Is there anything that's really affected you?
You know, it's funny. I can't say I am a voracious reader in the kind of short form. There has been a painful lack of time over the kind of the last decade of my life to be able to, you know, certainly do, you know, much pleasure reading. But, you know, there definitely are books that, you know, have stuck with me, have weighed with me, that have nothing to do, you know, with finance. I mean, obviously there are kind of finance books that were important to me with regards to some of the kind of the classics, you know, that we had to read in training, and obviously, you know, handbooks and manuals and things like that, that I could go into. But, you know, it's books like The Giving Tree. It's things that I used to be able to read, like, you know, anything from John Krakauer, you know, certainly, you know, his you know, Into Thin Air, things like that. You know, there's his book on Pat Tillman, one of my children after Pat Tillman, like just really deeply introspective pieces that, you know, have stuck with me over the years. That's the stuff that, you know, sticks with me for all time, you know, as opposed to, you know, something that kind of challenges your way of thinking. You know, I'm kind of a more inward facing person, which I didn't realize until I did a psychological test a few years ago. And it was good for me to come to terms with that, you know, especially like stories of loners and stories of people who, you know, doing a lot of introspection.
Yeah, it's true, because I think culturally there's so much pressure for people to be extroverts and be out there and be social. And it's, you know, if you're a loner or introvert, culturally it's a bit harder to feel part of the broader narratives.
Yeah. It's you know what it does, it affirms, I think, my ability to try to stand out, you know, to be not just a foolish contrarian, but to try to have an educated view and not be afraid to, you know, stand out from the pack and differentiate oneself and take risks. You know, those types of books have you know, served me.
Yeah.
From my experience. Yeah.
Well, that's been excellent. I've taken up a huge amount of your time, and I particularly enjoyed the second half or the last part of our conversation. You know, I feel as though we could almost, you know, have an hour on that. So I just wanted to thank you very much. And just one question, if people wanted to follow your work, is there a way they can or not?
Yeah. So it's, first of all, I appreciate your words. It was really nice to see you and hear your voice and catch up. Look, the dynamic, as I stated, is trading desk strategy. As I'm based within our global markets business, it, you know, it does require an interface with regards to our trading business at Nomura. So, you know, if you do have a salesperson institutionally, reach out to that salesperson there, but it's not a retail product.
So urge people to become a client of Nomura, and then they'll be able to get access to your research. That's great.
Exactly.
So with that, I just wanted to thank you. And yeah, it'd be great to stay in touch. And hopefully we'll be able to do one of these again in the future as well.
I'd love that. Let's keep it going.
Thanks for listening to this episode. Please subscribe to the podcast show on Apple, Spotify, or wherever you listen to podcasts. Leave a rating and let other people know about the show. Also, sign up to become a subscriber to our research at macrohive.com. We'll be back soon, so tune in then.